गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, दिस इज द फोर्थ वीडियो ऑफ चैप्टर 2 ऑफ क्लास 12th सेक्सुअल रिप्रोडक्शन इन फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स। इन आवर प्रीवियस वीडियो वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट माइक्रोस्पोरोजेनेसिस, स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ पोलन ग्रेन एंड मेगास्पोरोजेनेसिस। वी नो दैट मेल गैमेट आर प्रोड्यूस्ड इन पोलन ग्रेन एंड फीमेल गैमेट आर प्रोड्यूस्ड इन एम्ब्रियो सैक, बट बोथ दीज टाइप्स ऑफ गैमेट्स आर नॉन मोटाइल। They have to be brought together for fertilization. How is this achieved? Pollination is the mechanism to achieve this objective. Transfer of pollen grain shed from the anther to the stigma of a pistil is termed as pollination. You have learnt in lower classes that pollination is of two types, self-pollination and cross-pollination. Flowering plants have evolved an amazing array of adaptations to achieve pollination. Plants make use of external agents to achieve pollination. Can you list the possible external agents? They are insects, bat, bird, or even abiotic factors like water and wind. Depending on the source of pollen, pollination is of three types: autogamy, gitonogamy, and xenogamy. In autogamy, pollination is achieved within the same flower. Transfer of pollen grain from the anther to the stigma of the same flower is autogamy. In a normal flower which opens and exposes the anther and the stigma, complete autogamy is rather rare. Autogamy in such flower requires two important conditions. First is synchrony in pollen release and stigma receptivity, and the second one is that anther and stigma should lie close to each other so that self-pollination can occur. Some plants such as viola, common pansy, oxalis and comalina produce two types of flower. One is chasmogamous and the other one is clistogamous. Chasmogamous flowers, which are similar to flower of other species with exposed anthers and stigma. इट मीन्स वहां पर सेल्फ पॉलिनेशन भी हो सकता है और क्रॉस पॉलिनेशन भी, बट इन क्लिस्टोगैमस फ्लावर्स विच डू नॉट ओपन एट ऑल, इन सच फ्लावर्स द एंथर एंड स्टिग्मा लाई क्लोज टू ईच अदर। व्हेन एंथर डिहाइज इन द फ्लावर बड, पोलन ग्रेन्स कम इन कॉन्टेक्ट विद द स्टिग्मा टू इफेक्ट पॉलिनेशन। दस क्लिस्टोगैमस फ्लावर्स आर इनवेरिएबली ऑटोगैमस एज देर इज नो चांस ऑफ क्रॉस पोलन लैंडिंग ऑन द स्टिग्मा। Clistogamous flowers produce assured seed set even in the absence of pollinators. Do you think that clistogamy is advantageous or disadvantageous to the plant? The advantage of clistogamy is that plant can propagate itself under unfavorable condition, or we can see even in the absence of pollinators. The disadvantage is that there is self-pollination, due to which chances of variation and evolution of genetically superior plants is reduced. Second one is gitonogamy. Transfer of pollen from the anther to the stigma of another flower of the same plant is called gitonogamy. Although gitonogamy is functionally cross-pollination involving a pollinating agent, but genetically it is self-pollination since the pollen comes from the same plant. The third one is xenogamy. Xenogamy means transfer of pollen grain from the anther to the stigma of different plant. This is the only type of pollination which during pollination brings genetically different types of pollen grain to the stigma. Now we are coming to agents of pollination. Plants use two abiotic, wind and water, and one biotic, animals agents to achieve pollination. Majority of plant use biotic agents for pollination. Only a small proportion of plants use abiotic agents. Pollen grain coming in contact with the stigma is a chance factor in both wind and water pollination. To compensate for these uncertainties and associated loss of pollen grain, the flower produces enormous amount of pollen as compared to the number of ovules available for pollination. Pollination by wind is more common among abiotic pollinators. Some adaptations related to wind pollination are: wind pollination requires that the pollen grain are light and non-sticky, so they can be transported in wind currents. They often possess well-exposed stamens so that pollens are easily dispersed into wind currents, and large, often feathery stigma to easily trap airborne pollen grains. Wind-pollinated flowers often have a single ovule in each ovary and numerous flowers packed into an inflorescence. Wind-pollinated flowers have a single ovule so that maximum nutrition can be provided. The flowers are small and arranged in an inflorescence, so even if they have only one ovule, many seeds can be produced by an inflorescence. And also, it ensures efficient pollination, thereby leading to fertilization of it without wastage. A familiar example is corn cob. The tassels you see are nothing but the stigma and style which wave in the wind to trap pollen grains. Wind pollination is quite common in grasses. The next pollination agency is water. Pollination by water is quite rare and limited to about 30 genera, mostly monocots. As against this, you would recall that water is a regular mode of transport for the male gamete among the lower plant groups such as algae, bryophytes and pteridophytes. It is believed, particularly for some bryophytes and pteridophytes, that their distribution is limited because of the need of water for the transport of male gametes and fertilization. Some examples of water pollinated plants are Vallisneria and Hydrilla, which grow in fresh water, and several marine sea grasses such as Joystra. Not all aquatic plants use water for pollination. In majority of aquatic plants such as water hyacinth and water lily, the flowers emerge above the level of the water and are pollinated by insects or wind, as in most of the land plants. Means ye dono plants aquatic hote hue bhi pollination inme wind ya insects ke through hota hai kyunki ye surface se kafi upar hote hain. In Vallisneria, the female flower reach the surface of the water by a long stalk, and male flower or pollen grain are released onto the surface of the water. They are carried passively by water currents. Some of them eventually reach the female flower and the stigma. In another group of water pollinated plants such as sea grasses, female flower remains submerged in water and the pollen grains are released inside the water. Pollen grains in many such species are long, ribbon-like, and they are carried passively inside the water. Some of them reach the stigma and achieve pollination. In most of the water pollinated species, pollen grains are protected from wetting by a mucilaginous covering. So these are the adaptation in pollen grain also for water pollination. Both wind and water pollinated flowers are not very colorful and do not produce nectar. Can you guess what would be the reason for this? Flowers are colorful and produce nectar to attract insects like butterflies, houseflies, etc. for pollination. But in wind and water pollinating flower, there is no need of these agents, so no need of such characters. Next pollinating agents are biotic factors, means animals. Majority of flowering plants use a range of animals as pollinating agents. Bees, butterflies, flies, beetles, wasp, ant, moth, birds like sunbirds and hummingbirds, and bats are the common pollinating agents. Among the animals, insects, particularly the bees, are the dominating biotic pollinating agents. Even larger animals such as primates, arboreal or rodents, or even reptiles have also been reported as pollinators in some species. Often flowers of animal pollinated plants are specifically adapted for a particular species of animals. Majority of insect pollinated flowers are large, colorful, fragrant and rich in nectar. When the flowers are small, a number of flowers are clustered into an inflorescence to make them conspicuous. Animals are attracted to flowers by color or fragrance. The flowers pollinated by flies and beetles secrete foul odors to attract these animals. To sustain animal visits, the flower have to provide rewards also. Nectar and pollen grain are the usual floral rewards. For harvesting the reward from the flower, The animal visitors comes in contact with the anthers and the stigma. The body of the animal gets a coating of pollen grains, which are generally sticky in animal pollinated flowers. When the animal carrying pollen on its body comes in contact with the stigma, it brings about pollination. In some animals, floral rewards are in providing safe places to lay eggs. An example is that of the tallest flower of Amorphophallus. The flower itself is about 6 feet in height. और हम देख रहे हैं कि रिवॉर्ड के फॉर्म में ये इंसेक्ट को एग ले करने के लिए प्लेस प्रोवाइड करता है. अ सिमिलर रिलेशनशिप एग्जिस्ट बिटवीन अ स्पीशीज ऑफ मॉथ एंड द प्लांट यूका, वेयर बोथ द स्पीशीज मॉथ एंड प्लांट कैनॉट कंप्लीट देयर लाइफ साइकिल्स विदाउट ईच अदर. द मॉथ डिपॉजिट्स इट्स एग इन द लोक्यूल ऑफ द ओवरी एंड द फ्लावर इन टर्न गेट्स पॉलिनेटेड बाय द मॉथ. द लार्वी ऑफ द मॉथ कम आउट ऑफ द एग्स as the seed starts developing. So this is all about the agents of pollination. Majority of flowering plants produced bisexual flowers and pollen grain are likely to come in contact with the stigma of the same flower. Continued self-pollination result in inbreeding depression. What is inbreeding depression? It is the reduced biological fitness in a given population due to continuous self-pollination. Flowering plants have developed many devices to discourage self-pollination and to encourage cross-pollination, and these devices are called outbreeding devices. The first one is no synchronization. In some species, pollen release and stigma receptivity are not synchronized. Either the pollen is released before the stigma become receptive, or the stigma become receptive much before the release of the pollen. And the second one is different positions. In some species, the anther and stigma are placed at different positions so that pollen cannot come in contact with the stigma of the same flower, and both these devices prevent autogamy. The third device is to prevent inbreeding depression is self-incompatibility. This is a genetic mechanism and prevents self-pollen from the same flower or other flower of the same plant from fertilizing the ovule by inhibiting pollen germination or pollen tube growth in the pistil. Another device is to prevent self-pollination is the production of unisexual flowers. If both male and female flower are present on the same plant, such as castor and maize, it prevents autogamy but not zygonogamy. In several species, such as papaya, male and female flower are present on different plants, that is, each plant is either male or female, and this condition prevents both autogamy and zygonogamy. Next is pollen-pistil interaction. Pollination does not guarantee the transfer of right type of pollen, that is, compatible pollen of the same species as the stigma. Often pollen of the wrong type, either from the other species or from the same plant if it is self-incompatible, also land on the stigma. The pistil has the ability to recognize the pollen, whether it is of right type, that is compatible, or of wrong type, that is incompatible. If it is of right type, the pistil accepts the pollen and promotes self-pollination events that lead to fertilization. If the pollen is of wrong type, the pistil rejects the pollen by preventing pollen germination on the stigma or the pollen tube growth in the style. The ability of the pistil to recognize the pollen followed by its acceptance or rejection is the result of continuous dialogue between the pollen grain and the pistil. The dialogue is mediated by chemical components of the pollen interacting with those of the pistil. As mentioned earlier, following compatible pollination, the pollen grain germinates on the stigma to produce pollen tube through one of the germ pore. The content of the pollen grain move into the pollen tube. Pollen tube grows through the tissue of the stigma and style and reaches the ovary. You would recall that in some plants, pollen grain are shed at two cell stage, vegetative and generative cell. In such plants, the generative cell divides and forms two male gametes during the growth of pollen tube in the stigma. In plants which shed pollen in three-celled condition, pollen tubes carry the two male gametes from the beginning. pollen tube, after reaching the ovary, enters the ovule through the micropyle and then enter one of the synergids through the filiform apparatus. Filiform apparatus present at the micropylar part of the synergids guides the entry of the pollen tube. And all these events, from the pollen deposition on the stigma until the pollen tube enters the ovule, are together referred to as pollen-pistil interaction. The knowledge gained in this area would help the plant breeders in manipulating pollen-pistil interaction even in incompatible pollinations to get desired hybrids. Generally, breeders are interested in crossing different species and often genera to combine desirable characters to produce commercially superior varieties. Artificial hybridization is one of the major approaches of crop improvement program. In such crossing experiment, it is important to make sure that only the desired pollen grains are used for pollination and the stigma is protected from contamination, that is from unwanted pollen. And this is achieved by emasculation and bagging techniques. So what is emasculation? If the female parent bear bisexual flowers, removal of anthers from the flower bud before the anther dies using a pair of forceps is necessary, and this step is referred to as emasculation. Emasculated flowers have to be covered with a bag of suitable size, generally made up of butter paper, to prevent contamination of the stigma with unwanted pollen, and this process is called bagging. When the stigma of bagged flower attains receptivity, mature pollen grains collected from the anther of the male parent are dusted on the stigma and the flower are rebagged and the fruits allowed to develop. If the female parent produced unisexual flowers, there is no need for emasculation. The female flower buds are bagged before the flowers reopen. Is there need of bagging here? Yes, bagging is needed to prevent the stigma from unwanted pollen. When the stigma becomes receptive, pollination is carried out using the desired pollen and the flower rebagged. Next topic is double fertilization. After entering one of the synergids, the pollen tube releases two male gametes into the cytoplasm of the synergids. One of the male gamete moves towards the egg cell and fuse with the nucleus, thus completing the syngamy, and this result in formation of diploid cell, that is zygote. The other male gamete moves towards the two polar nuclei located in the central cell and fuse with them to produce a triploid primary endosperm nucleus. As this involves the fusion of three haploid nuclei, two polar nuclei plus one male gamete, it is termed as triple fusion. Since two type of fusions, syngamy and triple fusion, takes place in an embryo sac, the phenomena is termed as double fertilization, an event unique to flowering plants. The central cell, after triple fusion, becomes primary endosperm cell and develops into endosperm, while the zygote develops into embryo. Next is post-fertilization structure and events. Following double fertilization, events of endosperm and embryo development, maturation of ovule into seed and ovary into fruit are collectively termed as post-fertilization events. Let's discuss endosperm first. Endosperm development precedes embryo development. Can you think why? The primary endosperm cell, having 3N condition, divides repeatedly and forms a triploid endosperm tissue. The cell of this tissue are filled with reserve food material and are used for the nutrition of the developing embryo. There are three types of endospermic development. First is nuclear endospermic development, second is cellular endospermic development, and third is hilobial endospermic development. In the most common type of endosperm development, the primary endosperm nucleus undergoes successive mitotic divisions to give rise to free nuclei, and this stage of endosperm development is called free nuclear endosperm. Subsequently, cell wall formation occurs and endosperm becomes cellular. The number of free nuclei formed before cellularization varies greatly. The coconut water from the tender coconut that you are familiar with is nothing but free nuclear endosperm made up of thousands of nuclei, and the surrounding water kernel is called cellular endosperm. Third one is hilobial endospermic development, and in this, half of the cell develops in cellular mode and other half undergoes free nuclear division. In groundnut that belongs to bean family, the mature seed lack endosperm and it is completely consumed by the developing embryo before seed maturation. When these seeds germinate, the cotyledons become the source of nutrition for the embryo. However, in mature seeds of castor and coconut, the endosperm is retained as the storage tissue. And what about cereals? In cereals, the aleurone layer, which forms the part of the endosperm, stores food as well as secrete amylase enzyme for the digestion of stored starch during the germination of seeds. Now let's see the development of embryo. Embryo develops at the micropylar end of the embryo sac where the zygote is situated. Most zygotes divide only after certain amount of endosperm is formed. This is an adaptation to provide assured nutrition to the developing embryo. Though the seed differ greatly, the early stages of embryo development, that is embryogeny, are similar in both monocots and dicots. Under favorable conditions, zygote divides mitotically to form two cells. This cell is called basal cell and this one is terminal cell. Basal is at the micropylar end and terminal is at the chalazal end. Basal cell divides transversely to form 7 to 10 suspensor cell. The uppermost of the suspensor cell forms haustoria and the lowermost cell forms hypophysis. The terminal cell divide vertically to form two-celled proembryo, which further divide into four-celled proembryo and then eight-celled proembryo. These eight cells arrange themselves into two tiers. One tier form the radical and other one form plumule, which forms root and shoot respectively. Here, the zygote give rise to proembryo and subsequently globular, heart-shaped and mature embryo get formed. और ये जो फाइनली आपको मैच्योर्ड एम्ब्रियो का स्ट्रक्चर दिखाई दे रहा है, इसमें आपको सबसे ऊपर हॉस्टोरिया, फिर सस्पेंसर सेल, फिर रेडिकल जो रूट का फॉर्मेशन करेगा, फिर प्लिम्यूल जो शूट का फॉर्मेशन करेगा, और क्योंकि डाइकॉट एम्ब्रियो है तो दो कॉटिलेडन्स दिखाई दे रहे हैं. लेट्स सी द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ डाइकॉट एंड मोनोकॉट एम्ब्रियो. अ टिपिकल डाइकॉट एम्ब्रियो कंसिस्ट ऑफ एन एम्ब्रियोनल एक्सिस एंड टू कॉटिलेडन्स. The portion of the embryonal axis above the level of the cotyledon is called epicotyle, which terminates into plumule or stem tip. The cylindrical portion below the level of the cotyledon is hypocotyle, that terminates at the lower end in the radical or root tip, and the root tip is covered with root cap. Embryos of monocot possess only one cotyledon. In the grass family, the cotyledon is called scutellum, that is situated towards one side lateral of the embryonal axis. At its lower end, the embryonal axis has the radical and root cap enclosed in an undifferentiated sheath called coleurhiza. The portion of the embryonal axis above the level of the attachment of scutellum is epicotyle. Epicotyle has shoot apex and few leaf primordia enclosed in a hollow foliolar structure, the coleoptile. In monocot plants, the first shoot that emerges from the ground or from the seed is the epicotyle, from which the first shoot and leaves emerges. As ovules mature into seeds, the ovary develops into a fruit. That is, the transformation of ovules into seed and ovary into fruit proceed simultaneously. For most of the people, fruits are like papaya, mango and apple. However, for a botanist, fleshy and juicy mango or papaya are as much as fruit as the groundnut or cashew nut, which are dry in nature. Fruits are the final product of sexual reproduction that forms from the ovary after fertilization. In most of the cases, fertilization and fruit formation triggers the withering of other parts of the flower, including sepals, petals, and stamen. However, in some cases, like in apple, the floral part, like thalamus, becomes a part of the fruit. Such fruits in which other parts of the flower beside ovary are involved in the formation of fruit are called false fruit. On the other hand, fruits like mango, papaya, and grapes, they develop from only from the ovary, and these are called true fruits. Although in most of the species, fruits are the result of fertilization, there are few species in which fruits develop without fertilization, and such fruits are called parthenocarpic fruits. Banana is one of such example. Parthenocarpy can be induced through the application of growth hormones, and such fruits are seedless. तो हम ये देख रहे हैं कि अगर सिर्फ ओवरी से फ्रूट फॉर्म होता है देन इट इज कॉल्ड ट्रू फ्रूट. लेकिन अगर ओवरी के अलावा भी कोई फ्लावर का पार्ट फ्रूट फॉर्मेशन में कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन देता है तो उसे हम बोलते हैं फॉल्स फ्रूट, और इसके एग्जाम्पल हैं एप्पल एंड स्ट्रॉबेरी. और अगर बिना फर्टिलाइजेशन के फ्रूट फॉर्म होता है तो इसे हम बोलते हैं पार्थेनोकार्पिक फ्रूट. इफ वी सी द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ फ्रूट, इट इज मेड अप ऑफ टू पार्ट्स मेनली, पेरिकार्प एंड सीड. द पेरिकार्प इज द फ्रूट वॉल दैट डेवलप्स फ्रॉम द वॉल ऑफ द ओवरी, एंड द सेकेंड पार्ट दैट इज सीड इज एक्चुअली अ फर्टिलाइज्ड ओव्यूल. सीड्स आर फॉर्म्ड इनसाइड फ्रूट्स. अ सीड टिपिकली कंसिस्ट ऑफ सीड कोट, कॉटिलिडन्स एंड एम्ब्रियो एक्सिस. द कॉटिलिडन्स ऑफ द एम्ब्रियो आर सिंपल स्ट्रक्चर्स. दे आर जनरली थिक एंड स्वोलन ड्यू टू स्टोरेज ऑफ फूड रिजर्व एज इन लिक्यूम्स. Mature seeds may be non-albuminous, or we can say ex-albuminous, or they can be albuminous. Albuminous seeds retain a part of endosperm as it is not completely used up during embryo development, and the examples are wheat, maize, barley, and castor. And the second type is non-albuminous, or we can say ex-albuminous seed. In these type of seed, they have no residual endosperm as it is completely consumed during embryo development. For example, pea and groundnut. Occasionally, there are some seeds also, such as black pepper and beet. Remnants of nucellus are also persistent, and this residual persistent nucellus is the perisperm. A seed is enclosed in a tough outer protective covering called seed coat, which are actually the hardened integuments of ovules. The micropyle portion remains as a small pore in the seed coat, and this facilitates entry of oxygen and water into the seed during germination. As the seed matures, its water content is reduced and seeds become relatively dry. The general metabolic activity of the embryo slows down. The embryo may enter a state of inactivity called dormancy, or if favorable conditions are available, that is adequate moisture, oxygen, and suitable temperature, then they germinate. Seeds offer several advantages to angiosperms. Firstly, since reproductive processes such as pollination and fertilization are independent of water, seed formation is more dependable, or we can say reliable. Also, seeds have better adaptive strategies for dispersal to new habitats and help the species to colonize in other areas. As they have sufficient food reserves, young seedlings are nourished until they are capable of photosynthesis of their own. The hard seed coat provide protection to the young embryo. Being product of sexual reproduction, they generate new genetic combinations leading to variations. Seed is the basis of our agriculture. Dehydration and dormancy of mature seed are crucial for storage of seed, which can be used as food throughout the year and also to raise crop in the next season. How long do the seeds remain alive after they are dispersed? This period again varies greatly. In a few species, the seed lose viability within few months. Seeds of a large number of species live for several years also. Some species can remain alive for hundreds of years. There are several records of very old yet viable seeds. The oldest is that of lupin. Lupinus arcticus, excavated from Arctic tundra, the seed germinated and flowered after an estimated record of 10,000 years of dormancy. A recent record of 2,000 years old viable seed is of date palm Phoenix dactylifera, discovered during the archaeological excavation at King Heorot's palace near the Dead Sea. Nowadays, hybrid varieties of several of our food and vegetable crops are being extensively cultivated. Cultivation of hybrid seeds has tremendously increased productivity. But one of the problems of hybrid is that hybrid seeds have to be produced every year. If the seed collected from the hybrid are sown, the plant in the progeny will segregate and do not maintain hybrid characters. Production of hybrid seed is also costly, and hence the cost of hybrid seed become too expensive for the farmers. So what is the solution? If these hybrids are made into apomix, there is no segregation of characters in the hybrid progeny. Then the farmers can keep on using the hybrid seeds to raise new crop year after year, and he does not have to buy hybrid seed every year. So what is important to know here is, what is apomixis? Although seeds in general are the product of fertilization, a few flowering plants such as some species of Asteraceae and grasses have evolved a special mechanism to produce seed without fertilization, and this is called apomixis. What is fruit production without fertilization called? It is called parthenocarpy. Thus, apomixis is a form of asexual reproduction that mimics sexual reproduction. There are several ways of development of apomictic seeds. In some species, the diploid egg is formed without reduction division and develops into embryo without fertilization. तो नॉर्मली हम देखते हैं कि सेक्सुअल रिप्रोडक्शन में मेगास्पोर मदर सेल में मियोसिस होता है, चार सेल बनते हैं, तीन डीजेनरेट हो जाते हैं, एक बचता है जो एग सेल बनाता है, और फर्टिलाइजेशन के बाद वो एम्ब्रियो का फॉर्मेशन करता है. लेकिन एपोमिक्टिक सीड में मेगास्पोर मदर सेल में कुछ मियोसिस नहीं होता, कोई रिडक्शन डिविजन नहीं होता, और इसकी जो प्लॉइडी है वो डिप्लॉइड ही बना रहता है, वही एग सेल बनाता है. और यहाँ पे क्योंकि डिप्लॉइड एग है तो वो बिना फर्टिलाइजेशन के डायरेक्टली एम्ब्रियो में कन्वर्ट हो जाता है. इसलिए हम देख रहे हैं कि यहाँ पर सेक्सुअल प्रोजेनी फॉर्म हुई है जिसमें वेरिएशन भी होंगे, जबकि यहाँ पर मैटरनल क्लोन फॉर्म होता है. वे ऑफ फॉर्मेशन ऑफ एपोमिक्टिक सीड इज फ्रॉम न्यूसिलर सेल. मोर ऑफन एज इन मेनी सिट्रस एंड मैंगो वेराइटीज, सम ऑफ द न्यूसिलर सेल सराउंडिंग द एम्ब्रियो सैक start dividing, protrude into the embryo and develops into embryos. यानी कि हम ये देखते हैं कि जो न्यूसिलस के सेल हैं जो कि ऑलरेडी डिप्लॉइड हैं, उनमें डिविजन होता है और फिर वो एम्ब्रियो में कन्वर्ट हो जाते हैं. तो दोनों ही कंडीशन में एपोमिक्टिक सीड में बिना फर्टिलाइजेशन के सीड फॉर्मेशन हो रहा है. इन सच स्पीशीज इवन ओव्यूल कंटेन्स मेनी एम्ब्रियोज. An occurrence of more than one embryo in a seed is referred to as polyembryony. So this is all about pollination, its types, agents of pollination, their adaptations, outbreeding devices, artificial hybridization, double fertilization, endosperm and embryo development, about types of fruits and seed, and about apomixis and hybrid seeds. Thank you very much.